lockdown period, wherein we can't see each other and social distancing and all that. Well, this particular event organized by this our two bodies, AIFTP and GSTPM, made us to meet, to study, and to learn together. Well, I'm really thankful to both the bodies for giving me as well as Abhay this opportunity to go deep into a particular topic and discuss amongst all participants. So, respected senior participants and my senior members and dear fellow participants, we all will be very much happy to hear Abhay, who is a prolific speaker and a learned person from the family of learned practitioners. And I have also met him in person. And we all will be really enriched. Coming to the topic for today, about the issues in refund in case of inverted duty, inverted tax structures in GST. So here, very focused topic has been allotted by the bodies to us. And I'm also eager to hear Abhay. And I'll give my some needed comments at the end of his session in last 15, 20, 30 minutes, whatever Abhay can spare for me after finishing. And whatever questions arises, let somebody note it down and a principle-based question be asked to us at the end of the session. And let us try to make best use of the time available to us and request Abhay to take over.
So good morning, everyone. First of all, I am thankful to both the bodies, GSTPM as well as AIFTP, for giving me this wonderful opportunity to express my views on the nuanced issues on the topic related to refunds under the inverted rate structure. Now, before, let me just share my screen. I think I request Bhavya Bhai to just enable me to share my screen because I'm looking at a message which requires a permission from the host.
Yes, you can share the screen.
Still, I am able to see the same message that host has disabled attendees screen sharing.
Please try, sir.
Sorry?
You can try now.
So friends, before we move on to the topic, just let me share to just lighten the atmosphere, because when it comes to refunds, we all understand theoretically that refund should be allowed. But practically, when we see, it's very difficult to get the refund because sometimes, or rather all the times, government thinks as if that when we are asking for the refund, we are asking for some grant from them. What they forget is that it is our own money that we are seeking back and not some kind of a concession or a grant that the government in their charity bestows on the taxpayer. Now, having said that, in fact, interestingly, one of the good anecdote that I remember, in fact, Mullah Nazruddin started once a business, and the tax department came for audit, and they found out some issues, and they said that we are glad that there are no major issues that we could find. And you should be thankful that you are paying tax, and you are paying tax with a smile. So the Mullah Nasruddin said that now I am relieved, because he was very tense when that audit was going on. And the reason of for his relief was, he said to the tax officers that it is good that you said that I am ta paying tax with a smile, because I thought I have to pay tax with the money. So in fact, that is the reality. In fact, we all love to pay taxes with our smile. The only difficulty comes when we have to pay taxes with our money. And that is where, in fact, in the case of refunds, the issue becomes more serious, for the fact that it is a fact that we have already paid the money and now we are seeking it from the government. Now, having said that, let us move to the presentation. What I intend to cover is the nuances of the topic, because as I understand, all the viewers are aware about the basics of how GST works and what kind of refunds are available under the law. Having said that, we'll revisit certain basics, because only then we can go into the nuances and the critical appraisal of the concerned legal provision. So we are going first to discuss that whether refund is a constitutional right or whether it is a statutory right. There is a big difference between both the rights. A right, you can say, is a constitutional right if it flows from the constitution. And a statutory right is a right which flows from a particular statute. In our case, the GST laws, the CGST Act, the SGST Act, and the IGST Act. Now, what is the difference? The difference is that if it is a constitutional right, then a lot of impediments that a particular taxpayer might face in seeking a refund, which is by a constitutional right, would not be there as compared to a lot of impediments that he would find when it comes to seeking a refund under a statutory right. Because when someone seeks a refund under a statutory right, he has to comply with the provisions of that particular statute which has given them the right. But when one seeks a refund as a constitutional right, then a lot of impediments, a lot of procedural difficulties that he might have faced, all of that is overlooked, is largely overlooked by the courts, and the remedy in the form of refund is granted. What is the meaning of the term refund? If you see the law dictionary, it says repayment, as I discussed at the initial point, that it is basically a repayment of the taxes that we have already paid. It is not a concession or a grant that is given by the government when it comes to refund. Under Section 2, the word refund is not defined. However, we find the definition under Section 54, which is basically a section that we will do a deep dive just after this particular slide. So in that, the refund is defined in an inclusive way, where it includes refunds not only on account of zero-rated supplies, but also refunds which are specifically covered under Subsection 3 of Section 54. And that is where the refunds, even under the inverted tax structure, gets covered. So by and large, it's an inclusive definition. Now, whether this particular refund under the inverted rate structure, is it a constitutional right or is it a statutory right? That we need to first understand, because as we discussed, if it's a statutory right, then we need to have a very critical examination of certain provisions in that particular statute, along with the rules, to really appreciate whether someone is eligible for the refund or not. Now, what is the now when we look at the constitution, you will find that there is Article 265, which says that no tax shall be levied or collected except by the authority of law. So what Supreme Court did in case of Mafatlal, it's a landmark decision on the broader aspect of the principles governing the various kinds of refunds. What the Supreme Court essentially said, that they divided the category of refund into certain types. So first type that Supreme Court said was a refund that arises because some levy is declared unconstitutional, which is basically coming from Article 265. Because if certain levy itself is declared as unconstitutional, then whatever money that person might have paid, he becomes eligible, because that no longer remains the tax. It partakes the character of a deposit. And therefore, it is a constitutional right that the government cannot retain that money, which is not under the authority of law. And therefore, those refunds are largely granted without much embargo, without much restrictions. The only issue to examine here is that such kinds of refunds are generally granted only by filing a writ petition, because it is a writ court which has a jurisdiction to grant refund in such scenarios, because this is not arising out of a statute. This is arising out of the constitutional provisions. Then the second category are illegal levy. So these are basically the refunds wherein the constitution allows the lawmakers to frame laws in a particular domain on a particular subject. However, the interpretation of that statutory provisions results into a levy being declared as illegal, and consequently a refund may arise. Now, these are not the refunds which are actually arising under Article 265 of the Constitution, because constitutionally the provisions may be valid, but the legal interpretation of that particular provision, for example, in GST, the levy is on supply. Now, the scope of supply under Section 7 is prone to multiple views. So if tomorrow, if the courts find that a particular transaction, for example, if there is a transaction by way of a partition and a property or property in goods is transferred to some other person, whether a transaction of a partition would be considered as a supply or not would be a question. Assuming the courts declare that it is not covered in the scope of supply, and if someone has paid the tax on such transaction and if he has borne the burden of that tax, then he can seek the refund, but not on the ground that the levy is unconstitutional, but on the ground that the interpretation done by that particular officer when he imposed that levy was illegal, and accordingly, consequently, the refund claim gets arisen. The third category is mistake of law. Someone, the constitutionality is not challenged. The legal provisions are clear, but there was a mistaken belief of that particular taxpayer. He misread the law. And in that context, he probably paid some money which he was not required to pay. And once he realizes that mistake, he seeks the refund from the government. So these are the third categories of refunds. Here again, the courts have by and large held these are the refunds which are again arising under the statutory provision. So a lot of limitations, including time related limitations, would apply in such case. Time related limitations do not apply to the first category, but for the rest of the category, it does apply. Then there is a fourth category, excess payment in GST law. For example, if someone has deposited money in cash ledger and if he does not want to utilize that money and if he wants that money to be refunded. So these are the cases of excess payment where there is no issue, no question of any levy being unconstitutional, illegal or any mistake. Simply someone has paid by error more than what he was required to pay. And again, those are the fourth category of refunds. And the last category, which is relevant for us, is the refunds which are arising from the statute. So when we look at Section 54, we will see the circumstances under which the refunds are eligible. So those are the refunds which are arising under a statute. These are not the refunds which are arising under the Constitution, because essentially under Section 54, we are seeking the refund of the accumulated input tax credit. It is not a question of any levy being declared unconstitutional and any tax which you have paid on the outward side for which you are seeking the refund. It is a tax of the accumulated input tax credit for which you are seeking the refund. And that refund, the right is arising only from the statute, only from the GST Act. It is not arising from any constitutional provisions. And therefore, we can say that the refund under the inverted rate structure would be a statutory right. It would not be a constitutional right. So a particular claimant needs to pay careful attention to the language of the law, to the procedural aspects of the law, to the time limits given in the law, because all of that would become relevant and important. And any breach or any non-compliance or any misinterpretation of these provisions will result into the denial of the claim. And even at the higher courts, the scope of granting the refunds would be limited if there is a breach in those statutory provisions. So with that background, let us understand Section 54. I have tried to capture all the relevant aspects related to our topic. And then when we go to the rules, first we are going to discuss the provisions of the Act. Now, Section 54 deals with the refunds under GST law. Now, if you see Section 54, subsection 1, it's a basically a generic provision which says that any person can claim the refund of any tax and interest, if any, that he has paid on that tax or interest. And then it provides for the time limit that such claim should be made before the expiry of 2 years from the relevant date. This aspect of time limit we will visit little later in the context of inverted rate structures. But what point that I want to drive home in this particular provision is that if you see Section 54(1) till the end, it says that the law is giving a right to claim the refund, and the form and the manner of claiming that refund would be prescribed. Now, the word prescribe has been defined in Section 2. It says prescribe by way of rules. So then we go to the rules, which is a form of a delegated legislation where it provides the form and the manner in which those refunds can be claimed. Now, the word form and manner, there is a very landmark case of Supreme Court in case of K.I. Abraham in the context of sales tax law, where they said that when the Act uses the word form and manner, it refers only to the mode in which the things are to be done. So it refers to only the procedural aspects which can be given to the delegated legislation in terms of rules. The fundamental aspects of that particular issue or that particular subject cannot be delegated. Now, here, as you can see, the time limit aspect is covered in the statute itself. The time limit aspect has not been delegated to the legislation, and that is rightly so, because the law, when it asks the executives to determine the form and the manner of granting the refund. That form and manner would not cover the time limits dealing with the period up to which he can file the refund application. And therefore, rightly, they have provided the time limit within the statute itself and not left it to the rules, because had they left it to the rules in fact could not have ever been formed to provide such time limit, for the reason that only form and manner can be decided by the rules. The time limits cannot be decided by the rules. And in fact, just a slight digression, you will appreciate that when recently that section 140 dealing with the transitional provisions has been amended, where because of the said decision, the lawmakers had to amend the provision, because the transitional provisions only gave the right to the executive by way of coming out with the rules only in respect of the form and the manner of granting the transitional credits. The executive were not given the right to determine the time limits within which that right needs to be exercised. And that is the reason why they have now amended retrospectively section 140 to say that even by way of a delegated legislation, time limits can also be notified. Not going into that issue further, but I would still submit that just that retrospective amendment would not cure the other defects which are there in section 140, which probably some other day or some other speaker would dive deep into it. But for the purpose of refunds, only the form and manner can be exercised by way of a delegated legislation. All other fundamental aspects has to be put in the act itself, and it cannot be put in the rules. We'll again come back to this point when we go to Rule 89, Subrule 5, which deals with the formula for determining the eligible refund amount. Now, we go to Section 54, Subsection 3. This is the most important provision. We'll spend some time to understand the nuances of this provision when it comes to the refunds under the inverted rate structure. Now, friends, we all generally use the word inverted rate structure casually to mean that a business where the rate of tax which is applicable on my outward tax, outward supplies, is lower than the rate of tax that I am paying on my inward supplies, and that is the reason why the credits are getting accumulated, and therefore I need to seek the refund of those credits to convert those credits into cash. So that is how in layman terms we understand the inverted rate structure. But when we look at the law does not understand the term inverted rate structure in that manner. So let us understand that in detail, what the law understands, what the law means by the term that we generally use of inverted rate structure. So Section 54, Subsection 3 says that subject to the provisions of Subsection 10, we'll go to Subsection 10 later. It's basically dealing with procedural aspect. A registered person may claim refund of any unutilized input tax credit at the end of any tax period. And then the proviso says that no refund of unutilized credit shall be allowed except in two cases. First case is zero rated supplies, which is not at present for discussion. And the second scenario, which is actually for discussion, is where the credit has accumulated on account of rate of tax on inputs being higher than the rate of tax on output supplies. Now, many issues will come up when we understand this provision. So let us deal with each and every issue carefully. So first issue is what they mean by the term inputs. Because the reason is, if you see the law, the inverted rate structure would only appear when the rate of tax on inputs is higher than the rate of tax on output supplies. So there is a difference in terminology. On the input side, only the rate of tax on inputs are to be seen. Whereas on the output side, not only the output in terms of supplies by way of goods are to be seen, but even the supplies by way of services are also to be seen. And the rate applicable on those services is also to be seen. And then the comparison needs to be done, that what is the rate which is applicable on my output supplies vis-a-vis what is the rate applicable on my inputs. And if I find that the rate on my output supplies is higher, I become eligible to claim the refund of the unutilized input tax credit that I may be having in my online electronic credit ledger. Now, the word input is important. Now, whether the word inputs would only be restricted to goods or it would also expand and cover even services for that matter. Now, the word inputs in a plural sense is not defined in the law, but in a singular sense, it has been defined under Section 2, Subsection 59 to mean only goods. So the definition clearly excludes services. The definition also clearly excludes capital goods. Now, can we say that the word inputs in a plural sense used in section 54, subsection 3, subclause 2 would also cover services, for the reason that the definition of input under section 259 should not apply, because that is in the context of inputs, and what we are actually looking at is inputs and not input. So can we make this differentiation to say that when I look at this provision of section 54.3, I will look at not only the rate of tax on my inputs, but even the rate of tax on my input services. Going by the way the word input has been defined, and inputs being a plural of the term input, I will be of the opinion that the word inputs used in section 54.3 subclause 2 would be only restricted to the inputs in the context of goods. It would not extend to inputs in the context of services. However, this would not mean that you cannot claim the refund of ITC accumulated on account of input services. That topic we'll discuss just in a while. But for the purpose of deciding whether I fall under the subclause 2, I would submit that when you look at the provision, it categorically asks you to compare only the rate of tax on inputs vis-a-vis the rate of tax on output supplies. So I would be of the view that here, when you see the rate of tax on inputs, you only look at the rate of tax on input of goods, not a rate of tax applicable on services or capital goods. Now, someone may say that in the earlier Finance Act 94, there was section 65, subsection 19, in the context of business promotion services, where there was an explanation added which says that the word inputs would also include goods as well as services. Can the said explanation be taken as a recourse to understand the word inputs used in the GST law and to say that even services get covered? I would not be of that opinion. The reason is, in this particular context, in section 65, subsection 19, that levy of tax was on a particular service. That service was defined to include the enabling by a person, by a service provider, of arranging the inputs for the clients in terms of goods or services. And therefore, in that context, the explanation later clarified that this word inputs would also mean goods as well as services. But that was in the context, even the explanation clearly said that it was only for the purpose of this subclause that the word inputs would mean all goods and services. So I would submit that this explanation cannot come to our rescue when we try and interpret section 54, subsection 3, clause 2, to say that even I would include services when I look at the criteria under which I have to determine whether I will be eligible for refund or not. Second, output supplies. Now, the word output supplies is not defined in the law. We have two definitions under section 2, subsection 82 of output tax, and 83, subsection 83 defines outward supply. So we don't have technically the definition of output supplies, but when you merge these two definitions, a view would emerge that essentially what section 54 subsection 3 is trying to say, that you have to look at the applicable tax on all kinds of outward supplies, be it supply of goods or be it supply of services. So all kinds of taxable supplies are to be seen, which are made by this particular taxpayer. And the rates applicable on all those kinds of supplies are to be understood and compared with the rate of tax which is applicable on your inputs only. And if you find that the rate on your outward supplies is lower than the rate on your inputs, then you become eligible for claiming the refund under section 54, subsection 3. So in sum and substance, we can conclude at this stage that when we look at subsection 54.3 clause, subclause 2, the scenario which is sought to be covered is only seeking to compare the rate on inputs vis-a-vis output supplies. So the rate of tax on inward services or inward capital goods are not to be looked at when we consider the eligibility under this particular subclause. Now, let us say a particular taxpayer is eligible under this particular subclause. So next issue comes up is whether the refund would be restricted only to the accumulated ITC on account of inputs, or whether the refund can also be claimed of the ITC accumulated on account of input services, or in fact, even on account of capital goods. Now, kindly friends, please appreciate how section 54 subsection 3 has been structured. Let us again go back to that provision to appreciate the view that I'm trying to share. See, when you look at this provision, it says that a registered person may claim refund of any unutilized input tax credit. So a provision starts by saying that what essentially is allowed as a refund is of any unutilized input tax credit. Now, you all friends understand the word input tax under section 2, subsection 62, to cover the credit not only in respect of goods, but even credit in respect of services, which would also include credit in respect of capital goods. So when you look at this phrase, any unutilized input tax credit, a clear view will emerge that what section 54 subsection 3 says, that you can claim the refund of any unutilized input tax credit irrespective of whether that unutilized input tax credit is on account of inputs or on account of input services or on account of capital goods. So that is first. Then the proviso says that no refund of unutilized input tax credit. Now, which unutilized input tax credit? The credit referred earlier, any unutilized input tax credit. So the proviso says no refund of unutilized input tax credit shall be allowed in cases other than these two cases. So the provision then says that we are going to allow the credit, allow the refund of any unutilized ITC, but the refund of that any unutilized ITC will be allowed only in these two cases. In all other cases, the refund of unutilized ITC input tax credit will not be allowed. So essentially what the proviso says that we are going to allow the refund of any unutilized input tax credit, but you should fall in this particular case. Now the word case has not been defined in the law. And when you look at the dictionary meaning of the word case, you will find that the case means a circumstance. It means a situation. So when you apply that meaning here to this particular proviso and you read that, a view will emerge that what essentially the law says, that these two subclauses 1 and 2 are the situations. They do not determine the amount of refund that you can seek. These two subclauses only determine the situations in which you can seek the refund. Once you pass this test, in a sense, once you say that your situation is falling in these particular subclauses, then I would submit that then you look at section 54.3, the basic provision, the parent provision, then you find that then once I satisfy the test of falling in this scenario, I can claim the refund of any unutilized input tax credit, be it that that unutilized input tax credit is on account of inputs or input services or capital goods. So that would be my view, that the word cases in this proviso has to be understood as a situation, not in a sense that these particular situations also determine the amount of the credit that you can claim as refund. The reason is very clear. If that would have been so, the first part of section 54 subsection 3 would have become redundant. This proviso would have been, should have been worded in a manner to say that the amount of unutilized input tax credit that should be allowed shall be limited to, and then 1 and 2 should have said that in case of zero rated supplies without payment of tax, the amount as determined by the rules, and in case of inverted rate structure, the only accumulated amount which is on account of inputs and not the accumulated amount in respect of input services or capital goods. So in absence of that language, the structure of section 54.3 would reveal that in the proviso, I have to only determine that whether my situation, my circumstance is falling within those two subclauses. If yes, then I go back to the parent provision and say that one, since I am falling in that particular situation, I become entitled to claim the refund of any unutilized input tax credit. And friends, you all understand that it is a settled proposition that a delegated legislation cannot restrict a statutory right created by the provisions of the Act. So when an Act enables the person to seek the refund of any unutilized input tax credit, any fetters, any restrictions put by a delegated legislation in terms of rules to restrict that refund only qua the inputs and not to grant the refund qua the input services or capital goods would not be valid. And therefore, I would submit that there is a very good case to argue in such scenario that I should be eligible for refund, not only of the unutilized input tax credit on inputs, but even in respect of input services. This point, friends, will again come back when we see the formula and the logic of that formula. In fact, when you look at the logic of the formula, that logic also defeats the purpose of section 54, subsection 3. Now, friends, having said that, there is a very interesting observation which has been made by the Honorable Gujarat High Court in case of Shabnam Petrofills. We'll again come back to this case later in context of textile industry and the issues related to the lapsing of the accumulated credit. But very interesting observation has been made by the Honorable Justice in this case. If you see para 16 which is the portion where they have given their view on provisions related to Section 54. If you carefully see what they are writing, they are stating that what Section 54(3) provides is for the refund of unutilized input tax credit in two circumstances. So the word cases that we saw in Section 54 subsection 3 has been understood as a circumstances by the Honorable Gujarat High Court in the case of Shabnam Petrofills. So this in fact gives more credence to the view that the proviso only deals with the circumstances. Once I satisfy those circumstances, as per the basic provision of Section 54 subsection 3, I should be eligible to claim the refund of any unutilized input tax credit. Any interpretation which is made contrary to this view would defeat the purpose of Section 54 subsection 3 itself. So that would again be my humble submission. Now, another issue, friends, to understand, we'll again come back to this issue of Section 54 subsection 3 later when we look at the rule, and I will explain how the formula is so illogically designed, and it is so atrocious that in fact it is not even carrying out the spirit and the intent of Section 54 subsection 3. But we'll come back to that slightly later. Last issue to discuss here, friends, is the concept of tax period. Now again, I will take you back to Section 54 subsection 3. What it says, that a registered person may claim the refund of any unutilized input tax credit at the end of any tax period. So essentially, the claim can be made of an unutilized input tax credit which is lying in your electronic credit ledger at the end of any tax period. So claim is not qua the credits availed for a particular tax period. The claim is qua the period at the end of which the input tax credit is available. So a simple example would suffice. Let us say today a particular taxpayer is looking at his online ledger, electronic credit ledger, and he finds that he has 10 lakh rupees of unutilized input tax credit that he is lying. That is lying at the end of, let us say, March 2020. Now, he finds that he is covered by this, the situations covered by these two sub-clauses. That is, he is under, let us say, under an inverted rate structure, and hence he becomes eligible for claiming the refund. Now, let us understand what this subsection 3 tries to say. It says that fine. So, 10 lakh is the amount of unutilized input tax credit at the end of any tax period. I am saying for me, March, I am selecting it as a tax period. At the end of that tax period, once I file the return for the month of March, I find 10 lakh rupees as the unutilized input tax credit. So I can claim the refund of that 10 lakhs. Now, when you go to the rule, the formula designed to determine the maximum eligible refund amount when it comes to ITC, they consider the ITC availed during the relevant period. So that is where now, how do we reconcile the act and the rule? So the manner in which we are reconciling it is, I look at the figure of 10 lakhs. So I say that, okay, I am eligible to claim the refund of the 10 lakh. Now, when I want to determine the maximum eligible amount under the rule, I have to see the ITC avail. So I go back, I consider for the month of March, how much I have availed the ITC. I apply the formula and I determine the maximum eligible amount. If it comes to 10 lakhs, then I don't have to go back further. I simply file the return application for the month of March and I claim that 10 lakh rupees as refund. If by applying the ITC available for the month of March in the formula, you find that the maximum amount is not coming to 10 lakhs, I go back. Then I add the ITC available for the February. I also consider the supplies made by February. I, in a way, consolidate my February and March return figures and then determine applying the formula that what is my maximum eligible amount. If it is again coming to 10 lakhs, then I make an application by combining those 2 months. If still the amount is not coming to 10 lakhs, then I go 1 month back. I go to January and I see. The law is totally flexible on this aspect. The law does not say that if you are applying for the refund claim of the unutilized input tax credit at the end of March, you have to compulsorily apply the formula qua the month of March only. Once you determine that what is the tax period at the end of which the balance is lying and you want to apply for the refund, for applying the formula, you can go back as you want, as much as you want, depending upon how you apply the formula and what is the maximum amount that comes out from that formula. If the maximum amount comes out from that formula is equal to what is lying in your credit ledger, obviously you will stop there. And those are the periods that you will bunch together. It may be 2 months, 5 months, 10 months. It may also cross financial years. That is also permissible. and you bunch all those tax periods, and then you see that and then you make a refund application. So that is first. Now, second, what we discussed earlier, friends, if you remember, in subsection one is the aspect of 2 years time limit from the relevant date. So what will be the relevant date in the example that we saw? Now that a word relevant date has been defined in that explanation to section 54. Explanation 2 defines the word to say that when you are claiming the refund of unutilized input tax credit under this inverted rate scenario, the due date for furnishing the return under section 39 for the period in which such claim for refund arises would be the relevant date. So let us understand and let us accept that GSTR 3B is a return under section 39. Now, once we accept the fact that 3B is a return under section 39, when you want to compute the 2 years limitation window, what the relevant date you have to consider, for example, in case of March, when I file the March return, the credit, the unutilized credit which had arisen of 10 lakh rupees, was it only for the period of March? Was it that when I filed the February return, at the after the filing of the return, my credit balance was zero, and it is only in the month of March that the entire 10 lakh rupees has arisen? If that is so, then the due date for March, let us say due date for March for the sake of simplicity, is 20th April, ignoring the extensions that have been given due to COVID-19. So if that be the case, if the entire accumulation happened in the month of March itself, then 20th April becomes the relevant date. So 2 years from that, so 20th April 2022, that will be the time frame, the end time frame, the end time limit till which you can make the refund application for this 10 lakhs. Now, let us say for the credit accumulation not just started in March. It started maybe, let us say, in last June 2019. And when you apply the formula, you find that you have to consider the ITC avail from June till March to arrive at the maximum refund amount of 10 lakhs. Now, in that case, friends, since you started from June and you went up to March, I would submit that the relevant date for this particular refund application would be the due date for filing return for the month of June for the amount of ITC that you have availed in the month of June. So let us say the 10 lakh rupees refund, out of the 10 lakh, if you apply the formula to June, the eligible amount comes to 2 lakhs. Then you apply for July, August, September, you go on consolidating, and ultimately in March, when you bunch together, you find that eligible amount is coming to 10 lakhs. Now, when you make an application, you will make a single application, but the 10 lakh includes an application of the ITC that you availed in June and that remain unutilized and that continued till March and forms part of that balance of 10 lakhs. I would submit that in that scenario, for the 2 lakh rupees of portion, since it relates to the month of June, so the due date for filing return for the June, so that would be 20th April 2019. So for that 2 lakh portion of refund claim out of the 10 lakh, the 2 year time frame would not end on April 2022, but it would end in 28th July 2021. So that aspect needs to be seen. Normally people would not wait this much, but this is what, if someone has not been able to claim, then this particular explanation might help him to understand how this relevant date needs to be understood in case of inverted rate structures. Now, friends, the last aspect that I want to cover here, and then we move on to other aspect, is whether one-to-one correlation is envisaged under section 54, subsection 3. Now, my answer would be no. The reason is the refund which is sought to be granted by the statute is refund of an unutilized input tax credit. The entire GST law does not envisage one-to-one correlation. In fact, before GST came in, even in the Senwet era, we have leading decisions of the Supreme Court in the case of Daichi Karkaria, Eicher Motors, where the Supreme Court has categorically stated that one-to-one correlation is not required when it comes to availment of the credit. So I would submit that when you even look at Section 54, what you have to look at is the unutilized input tax credit, not on one-to-one basis that when I purchase the inputs, when I made the outward supplies, and only then I have to determine the eligible refund amount. I would submit that that would be a wrong interpretation. You have to just look at unutilized amount. You have to go back to as many months as you require, depending upon the formula that we are going to see in a while, and accordingly determine the maximum eligible refund amount. And accordingly, you can make an application. One-to-one correlation is not important. Now, that also one-to-one correlation aspect becomes very important, because as I understand, the chairman of GSTPA specifically asked me to tackle this issue of a recent circular, circular number 135, which was issued dated 31st March, where a view has been taken in that circular that the inverted rate structure would not cover cases where the inputs and outputs are the same. So let me first deal with that and we go to the other aspects of the two circulars on this inverted rate structure, which have been issued till date. Now coming to that aspect, that the circular says that basically the scenario covered in that circular was that many times the GST Council decides to reduce the rates and hence a situation may happen that a particular trader might be having a stock which he might have purchased at a higher applicable rate of tax, and post the notification and post the reduction in the applicable rate of tax on those particular supplies, on those particular supply of goods, it is possible that he might now be supplying that stock at a reduced rate, and therefore even after supplying the entire stock, he will still be left with the input tax credit remaining unutilized, and he may also foresee that he, this credit, he is not in a position to utilize it somewhere else or in his other transactions of that particular business. Now in that scenario, the circular says that this is not an inverted rate. Now that is a fallacy, friends. The reason is when we looked at section 54 subsection 3, the law, the situation only asks you to compare what is the rate on your inputs vis-a-vis what is the rate on your output supplies. The law does not say that if inputs and output supplies are same, the situation will not fall in that particular subclause 2. So friends, I would submit that in absence of one-to-one correlation in the GST law, in absence of section 54 subsection 3 subclause 2, putting a restriction to say that the scenario where the inputs and outputs are same will not be considered as an inverted rate structure, I would submit that to that extent, the circular has traveled much beyond what is there in the provisions of the Act. And as you all understand, it is a subtle proposition that circulars are only meant for supplanting the law. They cannot supplement the law. Recently, you can refer to even the judgment of Delhi High Court, where the same stand has been accepted even in the context of GST. And hence, I would submit and to answer the poser by the chairman that, in my opinion, this aspect of circular needs to be looked at by the government and needs to be withdrawn because it is clearly contrary to the provisions of the law. Now let us discuss other aspects of two circulars. So two circulars have come, 79 and 135. Let us look at 79. So first aspect is fine. We all understand the dispute was that whether tools and dies, which are not capitalized in the books of accounts, whether that should be considered as inputs, but naturally it has to be considered as inputs. But in some field formations, the view was taken that tools and dies are not inputs because they were still living in the earlier era of excise, because as you will also have witnessed that we have come to GST era, but department is still stuck in excise era. In fact, in VAT regime, if you see, department is still stuck in the sales tax era. They have not even come to the VAT era. So I don't know when they will come to the GST era and try and understand the concepts of GST. It will take a lot of time for that reality to happen before our eyes. Now, so that circular is anyway right to say that tools which are not capitalized would be inputs, and hence that situation where you have tools, where you have purchased the tools and the rate of tax on those tools is higher than the rate of tax on your outward supplies. Even that scenario, if you're having a ITC accumulation, you can seek the refund under section 54.3. Other aspect which we discussed, the circular is contrary because circular says that inputs would not include services and capital goods. But as we discussed, the word inputs used in that provides as a limited understanding in terms of only determining the circumstances under which a person can seek the refund. It does not quantify the amount of refund that that person can seek, and therefore to that extent I would submit that this aspect of the circular is again not in accordance with the legal provisions. And the third aspect is that when you look at the formula for calculating the eligible refund amount, you consider all inputs. Because some field formations took a view that no, when you go to the formula, we'll only cover the ITC on those inputs where the rate of tax is higher than the rate of tax on your outward supplies. But that again was a fallacious approach. The reason is when you look at the formula, the formula takes the entire credit, it reduces the tax applicable, and then the balance is only the eligible refund amount. So when you are taking the entire outward tax in the formula, obviously, you have to take my entire ITC. You cannot left out the ITC on those inputs which have suffered the rate of tax, which is either similar to my outward supplies or lower than my outward supply. So that also view has been clarified, that when you look at the formula, you consider the ITC on all inputs, not on specific inputs. Circular 135, three aspects. One aspect we already discussed. The two aspects, bunching of claims across financial years allowed. These also we discussed at length. How to read the word relevant date. And we saw that you have to first determine the period at the end of which the balance is lying. And then you can go back as much as you want, provided the same is within the window of 2 years that we discussed as far as the relevant date is concerned. So that again, circular is aligned with what the law provides. And the third aspect, which is again very draconian, the aspect of the circular says that when you calculate the ITC for determining the refund amount, you only consider the ITC which is reflected in 2A. Now, for today's limited discussion, I'm not going to go into the aspects of whether credit can be claimed or can be denied on the basis of 2A. I would only submit that 2A, my right of claiming the credit is not determined by whether the same is in 2A or is not in 2A. My right of credit is determined by provisions of section 16, subsection 2 more categorically. And when I fulfill the conditions of that provision, I would be of the opinion that this circular, even on that aspect, that for calculating the refund amount will only consider the ITC, which is there in 2A, would be again fallacious, because ultimately the formula is to determine my unutilized ITC. The formula, the circular and formula are not for determining my availment of ITC. So when they don't question my availment of ITC, when at the time of seeking the refund of that ITC, they cannot say that this ITC, although availed rightly, but refund will be restricted because it is not in 2A. That view will be clearly fallacious, clearly against the provisions of law. And therefore, I would submit that even this aspect of the circular needs to be withdrawn by the government. Now, let us look at section 54, subsection 4. So we looked at the nuances of subsection 3. Now let us see certain procedural aspects which are there in the Act itself, and then we quickly go to the rules. Now this deals with basically the documentary aspect, what all documents you are required to furnish. When we look at Rule 89, more particularly Subrule 2, Clause H, in case of inverted rate structure, the document which is sought, the statement which is sought from the claimant is the details of all the invoices on the outward side as well as on the ITC front. Related to the inputs, because as we will see later, the rule is actually against the provisions of Act. The rule only seeks to cover the ITC availed on inputs, and that is the reason why the documentation part in the rule says that you have to furnish the invoice details of all the ITC that you have availed on inputs, which has gone into the formula for determining the maximum refund amount. So that is the subsection 4 is categorically, basically I'm trying to provide the documentary evidence that one needs to furnish. Subsection 5, it is basically a provision under which actually refund order is passed. So when you, once you make an application, the order will be passed, all refund orders, not just under inverted rate structure, but all refund orders will be passed under this particular provision. Subsection 6 deals with provisional refunds. Now the law on provisional refunds do not apply to refunds under the inverted rate structure. It only applies to refunds arising on account of zero rated supply. So in case of inverted rate structure, if you file a refund application, there is no way you can get 90% upfront and 10% later on after verification. That provisions are not there for the inverted rate structure. A single order has to be passed by the officer granting you the refund under the law. A relevant date, we already had a look. Let us now see the part of the rules dealing with the inverted rate structure refund related provisions. So Rule 89 Subrule 1 deals with the form and the manner. So form is they have notified a form under which that now the process manner is online. So online only you can file the refund application. Documentation part we saw under Rule 89 Subrule 2 Clause H. It says that you have to give the statement containing the number and the date of all the invoices that you have received and issued during the year, which has gone into the refund calculation formula that we'll look just in a while. Subrule 3 talks about debit in the electronic credit ledger. This is natural because the maximum cap for which you can seek the refund is the unutilized ITC which is lying in your electronic credit ledger. Obviously, you cannot seek refund of something which is not lying in the electronic credit ledger itself. So, Subrule 3 says that if you are filing a refund application, whatever amount that you are seeking as a refund, it needs to be debited. So, it means in a way there should be sufficient balance in the electronic credit ledger for you to debit that money. And sub-rule 5, which is now will be our focal point of discussion, is the formula for determining the maximum refund amount under the inverted rate structure. So this is the formula. The formula looks cumbersome, but it is not so. Let me just simplify the formula. What essentially the formula is trying to say, it says that first you find out of the total turnover, how much turnover is of your inverted rated supply. So for example, my 60% turnover is on account of inverted rated supply. The formula says, fine, what we will do, the ITC that you have availed on inputs, 60% of that ITC we will assume to be attributable to this business wherein you are under the inverted rate structure. So for example, you have taken 100 rupees of ITC. The formula says we will attribute 60% of that 100 as the ITC attributable to the transactions which are under the inverted rated structure. And from that ITC, we are going to deduct the tax payable on the inverted rated supply of goods or services. And then we will determine what is the leftover of the ITC for which you can seek the refund under the inverted rated structure. So that is a, it would seem it is a logical formula, but I will explain with a live case that it is a totally illogical formula. It is basically a formula which is very atrocious. It is basically going against the basic spirit of the law itself, but we'll come to that in a while. Now, let us first understand certain components of that formula. So broadly, we understood how the formula, the logic of formula works. It says total ITC on inputs. You determine how much it is attributable to your inverted rated supplies. Now, how to identify that? The formula says you go on the basis of turnover. So out of total turnover, how much turnover is of your inverted rated supplies? If it is 60%, you attribute 60% of the ITC to that. From that attributed ITC, you subtract the tax payable on the inverted rated supply, and leftover ITC would be the ITC for which you can seek the refund, provided that much balance is available in your electronic credit ledger. So that is the basics of the formula. Now let us understand the each term used in the formula to understand the nuances. Net ITC is defined to include only ITC availed on inputs. But this is again, this has to be read in the context of our earlier discussion where we said that the law does not restrict the refund of only to the accumulated ITC on inputs. The law allows refund of any accumulated input tax credit. So I would submit that this particular rule is obviously going beyond what is envisaged in the Act. But having said that, let us understand this formula, let us understand this definition a little in detail, especially in the context of subrule 4A and 4B, because that would be relevant. So first you determine the ITC availed on inputs. Then it says from that ITC, you determine the amount of ITC for which you have claimed the money under 4A and 4B. Now, what are subrule 4A, 4B? In a nutshell, subrule 4A basically deals with transactions of deemed exports. So let us say there is a supplier who is making a deemed export transaction to a buyer who is located in India only. So the deemed export transaction, friends, you are already aware, one of the species is that against advance authorization, you can make a transaction of deemed export. So the buyer in India has given an advance authorization. I have supplied the goods as a deemed export. Now, since I have supplied as a deemed export, Rule 89 says I either supplier can claim the refund or the buyer can claim the refund. Now, let us say the supplier has claimed the refund. So the buyer has not paid that GST itself to the supplier because supplier has claimed the refund. Supplier has paid initially and then sought the refund. But that Indian buyer is also having other inputs or input services for which he is using that in conducting a transaction where ultimately he might be exporting the goods. So the subrule 4A provides that what about his other services and other inputs which are not covered under deemed exports, for which if he avails ITC and if there is no remedy available for him to seek refund of that, that ultimately becomes the cost. So to avoid that, subrule 4A says that in such situation that Indian buyer who has purchased from domestic suppliers inputs and input services not under the deemed export category, he can also claim the refund of those of the GST levied on those other inputs or input services. That is 4A. 4B is in context of merchant export and in the context of advance authorization and EPCG. So this is in sum and substance 4A and 4B. So what the formula says, if you have claimed something in 4A, 4B, obviously you cannot make a double claim, so you exclude that. So if you have not claimed anything in 4A and 4B, your entire ITC or inputs would form part of this calculation mechanism. Now let us see the word adjusted total turnover. Now this is interesting. It says you take the turnover in the state. Now what is the difference between turnover in the state and aggregate turnover? The aggregate turnover under section 2 subsection 6 is at a PAN level, is at an entity level. Turnover in a state is defined under section 2 subsection 112 to only include the turnover at a GSTN level. So if you are filing a refund for, let us say, a legal entity having a separate registration in Maharashtra and maybe another registration in Gujarat, if you are filing it for Maharashtra refund application, then when you see the adjusted total turnover, you see the turnover done from the state of Maharashtra. So it can be intrastate, it can even include interstate and even include exports, but all those transactions has to be done by the registered person in Maharashtra. The transactions of done by the registered person in Gujarat, which is a distinct person, would not be covered in the definition of adjusted total turnover when you file an application for Maharashtra. And this is very clear, friends, because when you are taking an ITC, you are only taking the ITC that you have claimed in Maharashtra. Now, obviously, when you are also taking ITC of Maharashtra accumulated in the Maharashtra GSTN and also considering the supplies under inverted rate from the state of Maharashtra, it could be intra, inter or even exports. I would submit that that is the reason why even the total turnover formula only covers the turnover in that state. It does not cover the aggregate turnover. Then in context of services, it provides for certain interesting adjustment. What it says, the turnover services, you cannot take blindly what is there in your return or what is there in your register of supplies. It seeks an adjustment. What is the adjustment that it seeks? It says that you exclude the turnover of services that you have done on the basis of the time of supply provisions, and you add only the actual amount that you have received in foreign currency for towards the supply of services. So let us say for the month of March, if you are claiming a refund application, there is a zero rated supply of services. Let us say the value is in INR terms 10 lakhs, but you have only received 8 lakhs. Then in the formula, in the turnover of Maharashtra, you cannot consider 10 lakhs, you have to consider 8 lakhs only. Even that 8 lakh may include advances in foreign you might have received from the foreign customer. Even that would be part of the turnover as far as the adjusted total turnover is concerned. But the amount which you have billed but not received would not be part of the turnover for that particular tax period for which you are claiming the refund. Another exclusion is exempt supplies. Now, exempt supplies are naturally excluded from the definition of turnover for the reason that you cannot avail the ITC which is attributable to exempt supply. We have a separate mechanism under Rule 42 and 43. And since you have not availed ITC, you cannot avail the ITC on exempt supply. So obviously, since the exempt supply, the ITC attributable to those supplies do not form part of your net ITC, even the exempt supplies on the outward side would not form part of your total turnover so as to make a fair comparison, so as to make an apple-to-apple comparison. Now, this is one of the most interesting aspects. Turnover of inverted rated supply of goods and services is not defined, because when we look at the formula, it requires four things. A turnover of inverted rated supply of goods, first, turnover of inverted rated supply of services, second, net ITC, third, and adjusted total turnover, fourth. Net ITC and adjusted total turnover is defined. But turnover of inverted rated supply of goods or services, how to compute that turnover? What will be covered and what will not be covered? Because the term inverted rated is, as we saw, is not used in section 54. So that brings to an interesting poser. Take this live example. It will bring home the point that I'm trying to make. So this is a particular business where he's having turnover of 100. Turnover 50 rupees out of that 100 is taxed at 5%, 30 is 12% and 20 is taxed at 18%. So his tax liability I have computed total tax liability on the outward side comes to 9.7. Now, this is very interesting, friends. When he does the turnover of 50 rupees at 5%, he uses lot of inputs. Some inputs are at 5%, some inputs are at 12, some are at 18, some could be at even 28. Similarly, when he is doing the business of turnover of 30 rupees, which is although taxed at 12%, it is quite possible that for doing that, he might be having inputs which are taxed at 18% or even 28%. And even in 18% category, it is possible that he might be having a single input at 28% that he might have used in doing that turnover. So the question comes that when I apply the formula, whether my turnover of inverted rated supply would only be 50, whether it would also include 30, or whether it would also even include 20. In a way, whether entire 100 rupees will be my turnover of inverted rated supply of goods and services, my answer would be yes. Because the only test that you need to pass is my rate of tax on my outward supply should be lower than the rate of tax on my inputs. Not all inputs. So even if I have a single input whose rate of tax is higher than my rate of tax on outward supplies, that transaction, in my opinion, would be a transaction under the inverted rated supply, and therefore even that would form part of my refund calculation. So this brings us to another interesting dimension. So one thing we have concluded that my entire 100 rupees of turnover would be a turnover under inverted rated supply of goods and services. A dimension that is brought in is I have separate ITC on inputs for all the three kinds of transactions. So 8 rupees is the ITC I have availed qua the transactions of 50 rupees. 4.8 rupees is 30 against the transactions of 30 rupees, and accordingly 3.2 is this ITC I have determined on the basis of assuming 80% of the turnover as a cost and applying the average rate of 20% on that cost. Now, if I apply the formula, if I say that my rule 89.5 formula for every supply under inverted rate needs to be computed rate wise, not in aggregate, then what would happen when I see the 5% rate category of supplies, I find that my ITC is 8 rupees, my tax liability is 2.5. So the difference would be my maximum eligible refund amount. Accordingly, for 12%, I find 1.2 rupees is my maximum eligible refund amount. For 18%, I don't find that, because even though there was a single input having taxed at 28%, but when I see in totality, my tax on outward supplies is higher than my ITC, and therefore there is no maximum refund amount which is coming out under the 18% category. So I add what is coming from 5 and 12% category, and I find that 6.7 rupees is what is my maximum eligible refund amount. If I do the computation by saying that the formula applies qua GSTN level, it does not apply qua the rate level supplies, then I have to see the total liability 9.7. I have to see my total ITC of 16. I have to see the difference and maximum refund amount as per the formula, then would be only 6.3. So friends, you can appreciate the difference. If you do the computation rate wise, the maximum refund amount would be higher. And the reason is very clear, friends, before your screen. The reason is that if you see in the context of 18% category, actually you have to pay the tax because there is a difference. My outward liability is higher than my ITC. So 3.6 and 3.2. So 0.4 is higher. Now that 0.4, since if I do it on rate wise basis, I have to exclude that entire negative 0.4. But if I do it in aggregate, then obviously that would factor in, that would actually eat away my ITC of 5% and 12% business. And therefore you find that when I do it at a GSTN level, the refund amount would be lower than if I do it qua the rate level working. Now, friends, I would submit here, looking at the formula and looking at the fact that they have not defined the term turnover of inverted rated supply of goods and services, I would submit that you can opt for the formula rate wise, because that is essentially the inverted rated supply. And accordingly, you can do this two computation separately of 5 and 12%, determine the eligible amount, and you can file the refund application. Obviously, system will have the limitations because system will not allow you to file two applications under the separate rate for the same tax period under the category of inverted rate. But that is, again, as we discussed, a system cannot guide the law. It is the law which has to guide the system. And therefore, I would submit that there is always an option, and you will find plethora of cases that have happened till date where courts have time and again asked the department to accept the manual letters, accept the manual workings in absence of system enabling the taxpayer to exercise the right duly granted by the provisions of law. So if you find that the amount is material, if you can do the calculation rate wise as compared to aggregate level calculation, then a view can be taken that you must file the refund application doing separate calculation and aggregating the maximum refund amount. And accordingly, you can explain to that officer the rationale behind taking that approach in absence of a definition of the turnover of inverted rated supply in the rules. Now, friends, let us see. I will not take more than 15 minutes now, because I want purposefully to leave the time for the learned Deepak bhai for his expert comments. let us see the formula first. See, formula text, most of the fraternity you will find on the trade side, on the industry front, say that the formula is logical. Because what they say, that you look at the formula, it says you take the ITC attributable to the inverted rated transaction on inputs, you subtract from that ITC whatever tax that you have, you should have paid on, that you have paid on the inverted rated supplies that you have done, and whatever is left over is your accumulated credit on account of inputs, and therefore that is what is eligible for refund. But friends, that is not so. I will explain you the illogic part of the formula. Now, very simple. This example will drive home the point. This is a live example. This is a case under the textile industry, because as you understand, the fabrics are at 5%, the yarn is at 12%. So that is why there they have this inverted rated structure. And now refunds are also available. So how this formula is cruel, that I will demonstrate. See the word, see on the expense side. So I have 60 rupees of inputs, which are taxed at 12%. So my tax amount is 7.2. I have input services at 30 rupees, which are taxed at 18%. So I have ITC of 5.4. I have a profit margin of 10%. So accordingly, my expense side is of 100 rupees, including the profit margin of 10. My ITC is 12.6. Now on the income side, I have only income of 100, taxed at 5%, which is a lower rate. And therefore, this is a scenario of, which is falling under the inverted rate. Now, see my accumulated credit. Accumulated credit is 12.6 minus 5. So that is 7.6. Now let us put aside the aspect of services, that whether services are allowed or not allowed, that is immaterial. That is a second, that is another issue that we already discussed. Now, even if we go by the logic that the law only provides the refund qua credit accumulated on inputs, is the formula structured in that way? The answer is no. See what the formula says. Formula says, take my credit on inputs, that is 7.2. From that, you deduct the liability on the outward supplies, that is 5. So what the formula says, what you are entitled for is 2.2 rupees of the maximum refund amount. But friends, is the 2.2 rupees my only credit which is accumulated on account of inputs? The answer is no, because what the formula forgets, that for paying 5 rupees of tax, I am not only utilizing 7.2, I am also utilizing 5.4 proportionately of input services. So if you see that way, what you will find that my total credit, my total payment of 5 rupees has happened from two sources. One is ITC on inputs, another source is ITC on input services. That nobody can challenge, that only you have used a single source of ITC on inputs to pay 5 rupees. Now, if you say that, what will happen that I have to see when I want to actually determine the amount which has accumulated on account of inputs, I cannot consider the output liability which I have paid from input services. So I have a ratio of 6:3, because 60 rupees is inputs, input services 30 rupees. Let us apply that ratio to 5 rupees. And what you will find that 66% of my 5 rupees is the portion that is paid on account of utilizing the ITC on inputs. The balance 33% would have been paid by utilizing the ITC on input services. That fact nobody can deny. So when I look at that, what I find that out of 7.2, the 5 rupees of output liability, only 3.3 has been paid by utilizing the ITC on inputs. The balance liability of 1.7 has been paid by utilizing the pro rata credit of input services. And hence, if we assume that the law is right, that only accumulated credit on account of inputs will be eligible, I am submitting that the formula is not in accordance with law. The formula is trying to ignore the input services, not only from the calculation, but even from the fact that you have not utilized it in paying any tax liability on your inverted rated supplies. That is wrong, friends. This entire 12.6 rupees goes into my electronic credit ledger. 5 rupees goes into my liability ledger. And when I offset it, it has to be considered that it is a pro rata offset. There is no method given in law, no provision in law to say that when you offset, first, we consider only input, the credit on inputs to offset, and then only we consider the credit on services to offset. So, friends, even assuming that my only accumulated credit on inputs will be eligible for refund, if you actually go by the pro rata calculation, the eligible amount would be 3.9 and not 2.2, which is coming out from the formula. So, you can see, friends, if you see in percentage terms, almost double the refund becomes eligible. If you actually do it on pro rata basis, even presuming that only inputs are eligible for refund, only ITC on inputs becomes eligible for refund. Input services are not eligible for refund. So if you strictly go by pro rata basis, it would be 3.9. If you go by law, where I submitted that even input services should be allowed, it should be 7.6. And if you go by the formula, you find it is only 2.2. So you see the generosity of the lawmakers, of the executive, when they drafted this rule, they have considered the least number, least amount for which you will be eligible for refund. So this is actually going against the inherent logic of the provisions of the Act, where they themselves are saying that the, whatever is accumulated, even if on account of goods, we will pay you back. The rule is going even beyond that. And again, it's a settled proposition. Rules are basically servant of the Act. A rule is not the master of the Act. Even if you see the rulemaking power under Section 164, it is only for the, it is granted for carrying out the purpose of the Act. The purpose of the Act is not being served by giving the formula where you ignore my entire credit of input services and assume the entire output tax to have been paid only by utilizing ITC on inputs. So even this can be a very strong ground to urge that the entire unutilized input tax credit should be permitted as refund in such situations. Let us quickly go through specific debarment. So even in inverted rate structure, the law says as reserved the power under subsection 3 of section 54 to identify certain supplies in respect of which, even if they are falling in the inverted rate structure, a refund will not be allowed. So that is the parent notification is 5 of 2017. This relates to goods. The other notification 15 of 2017 is relating to services. Now, because of paucity of time, we are not going to discuss this notification at length. I would only submit textile industry was suffering. So they amended this notification by 20 of 2018 to say that with effect from 1st August 2018, the refund will be allowed on ITC accumulated on fabrics. However, the proviso contained two provisions. One is this relaxation, this enabling provision of allowing the refund will apply only to those credits which are accumulated on supplies received on or after 1st August. So only the ITC that is accumulated on the supplies which are received on or after 1st August 2018 needs to be considered. ITC that you might have claimed earlier on supplies received before the date and forming part of your balance in the accumulated in the electronic credit ledger would not be eligible for refund. Second aspect, the circular says, and the notification says that whatever was balanced at the end of July 18 would lapse. Now that aspect has been litigated before the Honorable Gujarat High Court in case of Shabnam Petrofills. The High Court very beautifully analyzed the provisions of the entire Act. We already saw a glimpse of it earlier when we referred Section 54, Subsection 3. Essentially, in this circumstance, what the Honorable Justice said, that the lapsing of ITC, the power to lapse the ITC is not granted under Section 54. The Department argued that the power to deny the refund also implies the power to lapse. The Honorable High Court said no. If you look at the law, there is a specific provision wherever the legislators intended to give the power to lapse the ITC, they have given that, be it Section 17.4 or 18.4. Here under Section 54, neither under Section 16, any such specific power is given to lapse such ITC, and therefore the ITC cannot lapse. And definitely a notification cannot take away a vested right, which is already duly granted by the provisions of the Act. And hence the High Court struck down that particular aspect of this particular notification and said that credit cannot lapse. So you can continue to carry forward those credits. You cannot take the refund of those credits, but obviously you can utilize those credits in discharging any output tax liability that you might have. Maybe not today, maybe in tomorrow, but that is still open for the taxpayers to do. In the case of services, the debarment covers the services which are specifically covered under item 5, sub-item B of Schedule 2. So essentially, these are basically the services of construction of complex building, civil structure. So for this category of supplies, even though they might fall under the inverted rate structure, refund will not be permissible. Now, under the new real estate scheme, as far as the residential real estate is concerned, this issue will not come up because the ITC availment itself has been sort of debarred. You have to mandatorily pay 1% and 5%, and accordingly you have to discharge the tax without availing the credit. But still, for the commercial space, commercial sector, this aspect could be relevant. But now, also please understand, rule 42 and 43 has been recasted. Now the ITC attribution is on the basis of area which remains unsold at the time of receiving the completion certificate. So that also will eat away a lot of ITC which otherwise person could have thought of claiming it as a refund. And now the provision also specifically in notification 15 debars such developers from claiming the refund of the unutilized input tax credit. With respect to compensation, says there was an interesting issue, may not be relevant to all, but let me just highlight for tobacco and manufactured tobacco substitutes. See, in case of compensation cess, actually the Compensation Cess Act borrows all the provisions of the CGST Act. Now, so refund provisions also borrowed. So refund applications were filed in case where the compensation cess leviable on the outward supplies was lower than the compensation cess which was leviable on the inward supply. So that happened particularly in the tobacco industry. So refunds were getting censured. Suddenly the government woke up and they said that we don't intend to grant the refund even if it is an inverted rate under the compensation cess scenario, and hence they issued the notification 3 of 2019 to specifically now debar the suppliers of these two products from claiming the refund under inverted rate structure of compensation cess. GST refunds were anyway barred by 5 of 2017. But the corresponding compensation cess notification was never issued when 5 by 2017 came to be issued in June 2017. So they forgot that. So compensation cess refunds were being sought. GST refunds were denied from day one. But now this notification also seeks to deny the compensation cess refund under the inverted rate structure for the tobacco and the tobacco industry. Only interesting point to observe here, the council meeting said this will be a retrospective amendment because since GST itself was not allowed, how we can allow the cess refund? But interestingly, if you see the notification, it has not been applied retrospectively. So if someone is under this, probably department would try and call back the earlier refunds, but till this notification is not expressly applied retrospectively, there would be a very good case to argue that this will only apply prospectively and earlier claims should remain intact. Last two slides, friends. These are very interesting issues where you have two issues happening. You are under the zero inverted rate structure and you are exporting the goods under the inverted rate structure. So for example, you are making fabrics and you are exporting fabrics. So fabrics are under inverted rate and you are also making zero rated supplies. So how you can claim the refund in this scenario? See, that if you are exporting it with payment of tax, then under subrule 10 of rule 96, you would have sought the refund of the tax that you have charged on the exports. So if you have exported fabrics, you would have charged 5% and you would have got the refund under subrule 10 of rule 96, assuming that you don't violate any provisions of rule 96. Now, even after getting that 5% back, still you are having an accumulation of credit because your inputs are still taxed at 12%. Your exports, even though it was made with payment, but that payment with payment was also a 5% only. That with payment was not at 18% so as to absorb my entire ITC. So there will be situations where ITC would still remain. I would be of the opinion that you can claim the refund under 89.5, even under the inverted rate structure. For that, you have to calculate, as we saw in the formula, the total ITC on inputs, and then you have to subtract the tax payable on the outward supplies, which would also include the tax payable on the exports, because that also you paid and then you claim the refund, and the balance amount would be available for refund. If you have exported without payment, then both the rules would apply. Subrule 4 and subrule 5 would apply independently. Subrule 4 will apply to the extent of export transactions because that was without payment, and the ITC attributable to those export transactions pro rata will be permissible for refund, and subrule 5 will also apply independently. The only point to note here is, let us out of my 100 rupees of turnover, 60 rupees entire inverted rate, 60 is export, 40 is domestic. So the total ITC that you have availed, which is attributable to my export, let us say 60 was my export, that 60% of my attributable ITC, I can claim it under subrule 4. and the balance ITC attributable, I can claim it under subrule 5. That is the domestic transactions of under inverted rate. But the only point to note here, friends, is that subrule 4 allows me the ITC of input and input service. Subrule 5, as we saw, only covers inputs. So that is where, again, this is again a dichotomy that in case of zero rated supply, services are also permissible for refund. Whereas in case of inverted rate, only goods, only inputs are allowed. So this again gives one more force to the argument that when you looked at the proviso under 54.3, zero rated and inverted rate are treated at par. Now, if the Act treats both the situations at par, a rule cannot go ahead and differentiate and say that for certain one situation, we will give more refund and another situation will give less refund. Now, friends, the last slide before I end is planning. So this planning slide basically I intended to cover because, see, the discussion that we had till now, where you can say that input services are also allowable, capital goods also allowable, but that will take some time to resolve because things will have to go to the courts. And ultimately, we will have to wait for the judgment from the courts to come and confirm the view. Now, in the meanwhile, what could a person do? Because he is helpless, he is having accumulated credits, he is not having any option of utilizing those credits, the business is such, and the money is keeping on piling up and up. Whenever the investor calls such person to say that where are the profits, the person has to only say that the profits are with the government, because profits are lying in my electronic credit ledger. I don't know how to take the profits from that ledger and bring it into my bank account. So the person will have to tell to the investor in the company that if you want dividend, you go to the electronic credit ledger and you see if you can get dividend from the electronic credit ledger, because I cannot get the money in cash. Now, what to do in such scenario? So one option that we explored, this is all I'm sharing on the practical front that we did. One option that we explored was that there was a particular situation where a person was selling it to a dealer, distributor, distributor to dealer, and dealer was ultimately selling to the end consumer. So to absorb more credits, what we did, see, originally the person was selling his goods, let us say, at 5 lakh to a distributor. Distributor was selling it at 6 lakh and to a dealer, and dealer was selling it at, let us say, 7 lakh to the customer. So I was paying tax on 5 lakh under inverted rate and I was having credit accumulated. My distributor was paying tax in cash on that value addition of 1 lakh. Similarly, the dealer was also paying the tax in cash on that value addition of his 1 lakh, because he used to only take the credit of 5 lakhs, pay 6 lakhs, pay the difference in cash. Similarly, the dealer takes the credit of 6 lakhs, has to pay 7 lakhs, so deposits the 1 lakh by cash. So what we did, we said that instead of billing at 5 lakhs, let us bill it at 7 lakhs only. Let us issue a financial credit note for 2 lakhs. So by that, what will happen? That there will be no cash outflow at the later stage of the distribution chain. So the entire later chain of my chain of the distribution will be able to take the credit and pay the tax sufficiently from their credit. So they will not be required to pay the money in cash. And by giving a financial credit note, ultimately I am restoring the selling price to what I intended of 5 lakhs. But by this process, instead of my distribution chain, part of my distribution chain paying tax by cash, and I having an accumulation of credit, by this manner, some accumulation of credit can be taken out from the system and it can be, this problem of money getting blocked can be resolved. Second planning possible is job work. So for example, a particular claimant is under inverted rate structure. Input services, as we saw, the formula does not grant the refund. So to convert input services to inputs, what can be the legal way out? See, when you carry out job work, you have two modes: without payment, with payment. If you do it with payment, because anyway you are having credit balance available, so even if you do it with payment, ultimately you will end up paying through that credit only, so there will be no cash outflow. But when you do it with payment, when you get back the goods after job work with payment, with the value addition that he has done, I would be of the view that that would be the supply of inputs. That would not be the supply of input services, and hence a view can be taken that that ITC I can very well consider in the formula in Rule 89.5 itself, without going into this dispute of whether the Act allows me the entire refund and how a rule can restrict the refund only to inputs. And that is another way in which it can probably be structured. So friends, with that, I again thank both the associations for being kind enough to allow me the time and the opportunity to share my views on the topic. So with that, I hand over back to the members.
Yes. Deepak bhai, you'll have to unmute yourself. Deepak bhai, you'll have to unmute yourself.
Yeah. Abhay, let me tell you that whatever participants have heard you in last time devoted by you is really very much enriching